Good evening, and welcome to White House History Live. My name is Rebecca Califf. I am a resource specialist at the White House Historical Association. The White House Historical Association is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization with a mission to educate the public about the rich, diverse history of the White House and the people who lived and worked there. We do this work in a variety of ways through articles, educational resources, teacher and public programming, and other digital initiatives, including our digital exhibits. Tonight, I'm honored to welcome our guest, Sarah Fling. Sarah is a historian at the White House Historical Association and curator of the digital exhibit, Slavery and Freedom in the White House Collection. During tonight's program, we'll begin with a discussion of her exhibit, and then we'll open the floor for questions from everyone tuning in at home. Sarah, welcome, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, great to be here, and thank you everybody tuning in at home.
As a quick reminder for our viewers, if you have any questions for Sarah, please type them into the comment section in the live feed, and we'll try to answer as many as we can once we finish our formal discussion. We have a lot to get to, so we're going to dive right in. Sarah, your exhibit is titled Slavery and Freedom in the White House Collection. For anyone tuning in who's not familiar, could you talk a little bit more about the White House Collection and its history?
Absolutely. So the White House collection is over 60,000 historic objects, including art, furnishings, chinaware, and more. And this collection of amazing artwork is a testament to the work of First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. So previous to the Kennedy administration, we see presidents and first ladies, many of whom don't care so much about historic preservation, many of them auctioning, selling, or getting rid of old furniture to make way for new fashionable items. But Mrs. Kennedy was a really dedicated preservationist. She believed that the White House is the people's house and that we should really maintain the historic character for future generations. So as a result, these pieces are now cared for by a team of professional curators. Mrs. Kennedy hires the first curator. She founds the White House Historical Association, help with the acquisition of items and to spread that mission of sharing White House history with the public, as well as many other preservation efforts. So today, the White House is officially a museum. It is on par with some of the most important museums in the world. And the objects inside the White House collection really represent the very best of American fine and decorative arts items. I don't know if anybody tuning in at home has ever been to the White House, but even if you haven't, if you've seen video footage or photographs, you've seen many of these fantastic items. But there are even more that you can't see when you tour the White House. Many of them are in the private residence, in the West Wing, in the Oval Office, and some are even in storage, like you can see on screen here. But no matter where all of these 60,000 pieces are, all of these objects in the White House collection have really great stories to tell, which is what led me to create this exhibit, which explores stories of slavery and freedom through objects that are in the White House collection.
Thanks for that background, Sarah. I think it is a really important point that you make that while the White House is the office of the president and the home of the first family, it's also a museum that collects, displays, and cares for thousands of objects. What made you interested in this topic?
Well, this work specifically, looking at the history of slavery, the history of abolition, and its relationship to these objects at the White House, really comes out of our Slavery in the President's Neighborhood Research Initiative, which we launched in 2020. So we just passed the third anniversary. And this initiative that we've been working on now for many years seeks to tell the stories of the enslaved individuals who lived, built, and worked in the White House. And as part of this research initiative, I began looking into connections that we could find between White House art and slavery, thinking of a creative way to get at this story of slavery. And one of my own areas of focus as a public historian is in material culture or the study of objects. So everyday run-of-the-mill items that you might see may seem boring, may seem like there's nothing interesting beyond the aesthetic value of them, but they can actually tell us so many cool stories about people of the past. Objects really have the opportunity to reflect the economic, political, and cultural ideas of their owners, and they can embody ideas about race, class, identity across time. They also provide a unique opportunity to explore the lives of individuals who might not have left written records or whose written records might not have been preserved. So this is especially the case when we looked at enslaved people. So knowing all of these things, I was eager to combine this slavery in the president's neighborhood research that we were doing to tell these stories, as well as my own passion for art and material culture, into this exhibit that's an amalgamation of all of these things.
Yeah, that's really helpful context as we get into the content of the exhibit itself. So your exhibit begins far from Washington, D.C., looking at enslaved labor in South and Central America and the Caribbean. How are these stories related to the White House?
That's a good question. You know, we are the White House Historical Association, and all of these objects that we're looking at are physically inside the White House or a part of the White House collection. But the story of slavery is a much bigger one. It's a global story. And one of the first portions of the exhibit considers the White House collection and the Atlantic world context, specifically thinking about commodities and raw materials and their relationship to early American fine and decorative arts items. So one example that you can see on the screen here is a very popular material used in upper class North American homes. If you've ever been to the White House, and if you've ever been to any historic house, you've probably seen many mahogany items. And this was actually a commodity that was primarily harvested by enslaved workers, like those that you see on the screen here. On the Caribbean islands of Hispaniola, which today we know as Haiti, and the Dominican Republic, Cuba, and Jamaica, and also in parts of Honduras. And enslaved people were critical to the many steps of harvesting mahogany, from felling trees, like you see here, hauling logs, and preparing that wood for transport. It was actually demand for mahogany tables, chairs, dressers, desks, anything you can think of in an early American home that's really pushing the transatlantic slave trade. And this is first popular in Europe, but then moves into British North America. Because mahogany is a scarce resource, it becomes extremely expensive. So if you have a mahogany item in your home, like the desk that you can see here, it's representing that you have a certain status, wealth, civility about you, that you're able to get an expensive item like this. So this piece is in the exhibit. It's a desk and bookcase that's made by Thomas and John Seymour around the turn of the 19th century. And this is made out of mahogany. It's in the White House collection today. And this set is such a good example of the way that raw materials that are harvested largely by enslaved laborers abroad come into the homes of everyday Americans, especially affluent Americans. So even if you're not directly participating in slavery, it's indirectly touching many of these Americans' lives, or even prior to the creation of the United States. But the Atlantic world portion that I have in the exhibit doesn't only look at mahogany. Another commodity that it considers is sugar, which, similar to mahogany, is harvested by enslaved laborers in the Caribbean on many Caribbean islands. In fact, the climate in the Caribbean was ideal for growing sugarcane and was one of the major reasons that so many European powers tried to colonize the area. And we know from research that sugar plantations, like the one that you see in the print here, were especially dangerous for enslaved laborers as compared to other plantations, and that many, many individuals died from tropical diseases that you see there, unsanitary living conditions, and from sugar mill injuries, because the process of creating cane sugar and refined sugar from cane sugar is a very dangerous one. But like mahogany, sugar isn't only culinary. It comes to take on this new symbolism that represents your own social status, your own taste, and your own worldliness, and being able to get this taste that's created somewhere else. And thanks to increased sugar production, average consumers eventually are able to buy it at the market, put it into their coffee and tea, and partake in this ritual that shows you're part of the elite. And one of the objects that you see on screen here in the exhibit is a sugar bowl. This was owned by George and Martha Washington. They used it at their presidential household in Philadelphia prior to the creation of the White House. The Washingtons were the ones who lived in Philadelphia and New York. And this bowl was a part of their usage there. Because we see this increased production of sugar in the Atlantic world, you then see that people begin to make accessories to go with sugar consumption. So that means sugar bowls, sugar spoons, etc. So this is part of that world of creating new accessories to match culinary tastes. And this also is connecting everyday Americans to the transatlantic slave trade, but in this particular case, it's connecting the Washingtons to that global story of slavery. But this is also an interesting piece because, as many of us know, and I'm sure many tuning in are aware, the Washingtons aren't only connected to slavery through this larger global context. The Washingtons participate in slavery every day by owning many enslaved laborers and using them at their presidential households. So not only is this sugar bowl possibly cared for, cleaned, put out on the table by enslaved workers owned by the Washingtons, but they've also got an enslaved cook in the kitchen who's making the dishes that might be sweetened with this sugar. So there are a lot of connections that you can make between a simple bowl and the sugar production and slavery in the Atlantic world. So that's some of the interesting aspects that you can think about in the many layers of these pieces.
Yeah, so many connections and layers. Your exhibit also highlights the use of enslaved labor to built the White House and in several presidential households before the Civil War. How do you use objects to tell the stories of these enslaved workers?
Definitely. So this is the major part of our Slavery in the President's Neighborhood initiative that I wanted to pull into this exhibit is thinking about how enslaved people that worked at the White House would have interacted with objects there. Now, as you mentioned, the exterior of the White House itself is a testament to the craftsmanship of enslaved people. They worked alongside free laborers to make bricks, to quarry stone, to create the exteriors that we see on the White House. And this is also true of subsequent reconstruction projects after the burning of the White House, as well as landscaping and other things happening in the early 19th century. But we also know that at least 9 presidents brought, hired out, or relied on enslaved workers to fill roles at the White House, like valets, butlers, maids, nurses, cooks, you name it. And because so many of these specific roles include service in dining rooms and kitchens, that objects like a sugar bowl, a china plate, silverware, are pieces that you can tie to this story of slavery. These pieces were likely handled, cleaned, and cared for by enslaved workers during these presidencies. So it's all about the people that you can see behind the object, the human stories that exist when you look a bit deeper into these pieces rather than only looking at those design choices.
I think your exhibit is so fascinating because it's almost entirely based on your analysis of objects. Some that you mentioned that we may consider to be everyday or mundane to reveal these larger stories about the past. Can you walk us through your process when it comes to analyzing an object?
Yeah, so I like to think of analyzing an object like interviewing a person. You just have to ask good questions, and the objects are conversational, so it goes both ways. It's important to me to consider the use of an object, the purpose of an object, the people who are interacting with it, rather than only looking, as I said, at the design or the aesthetic value. So let's look at a couple examples that we have in the exhibit to show you my thought process. We'll look at a mirror next that's featured in the exhibit. It's this mirror that's connected to a dressing chest of drawers. And when you first glance at it, you think that's just a mirror. Mirrors are decorative items. Sarah, who cares? Why is this interesting? But then when you start to think about the purpose of an object, what are mirrors for? They provide a way to see yourself. They serve a role in morning routines. In fact, I bet many of us tuning in at home looked in a mirror today to get dressed, to shave, to apply makeup, to do your hair. So it's a part of these routines that we all have based on your own physical appearance. And for many of us, that might be something that we rely on ourselves to do. But for many presidents, the act of getting ready in the morning and the physical appearance of a president was actually something taken care of by somebody in the role called valet. And if anybody watching has ever tuned into Downton Abbey or other period piece shows, you're probably familiar with the role of a valet. Typically, a valet is a very intimate connection to the person that they're serving because they're with them all day, every day. They take care of their wardrobe. They assist with shaving and grooming routines. They would travel with presidents, and they provided any other assistance needed throughout the day. So this is a really important role in the presidential household. And this specific mirror and set of drawers, we believe, came to the White House during the presidency of Andrew Johnson. But Andrew Johnson's appearance was not his sole responsibility. It fell to his valet named William Andrew Johnson. You can see William on screen here. And William was actually born into slavery in the Johnson's household in Tennessee. He lived with his family in slavery for many years until he finally earned his freedom when Andrew and Eliza Johnson emancipated all of the enslaved people that they held in bondage just prior to them moving into the White House. So after Lincoln's assassination, when Johnson and his wife suddenly are thrust into the role of president and first lady, William actually continues to work in their household, coming to serve as White House valet in 1865. So William has this connection to this mirror just by the purpose of what this mirror served in the White House, of being part of this idea of routine of getting ready. So that's sort of the layers of that I asked myself when looking at that. But William Andrew Johnson, I have to mention, you can see in the photo here, he has a very interesting story that goes beyond these White House years, which is that in 1937, he was interviewed by journalist Ernie Pyle and gained national recognition. He's in the press many, many times because he's believed to be the last surviving individual to have been enslaved by a president. And as a result, President Franklin D. Roosevelt actually invited William Johnson to come to the White House for a meeting. And President Roosevelt gifted Johnson a silver-headed engraved cane, which you can see him standing here with on the steps of the Capitol. And then he did a nice tour of Washington, D.C., which is what he's photographed doing here. So he has quite an interesting story. But to give you another idea of an object that I tried to think uniquely, creatively about its role, we can go to the next slide and see a side chair. Now, this seems pretty boring, right? It's just a chair. But it was used in the cabinet room for several decades in the 19th century. Just as a reminder, the cabinet room that we all know today in the West Wing did not exist then. This was upstairs at the White House. And these chairs have an important connection actually to emancipation because they appear in Francis Bicknell Carpenter's painting that many of you have probably seen. It's right here. First reading of the Emancipation Proclamation by President Lincoln. The artist, Carpenter, actually lived at the White House for 6 months, basing his painting off of conversations and sittings with President Lincoln, as well as observations of the furnishings that were at the White House at the time. In fact, he wrote a memoir about this experience, and in his memoir, he wrote, quote, "I endeavored as faithfully as possible to represent the scene as it actually transpired. Room, furniture, accessories, all were to be painted from the actualities," end quote. So the final painting, which you can see here, it was approved by President Lincoln. He thought it was quite accurate. Features Lincoln and his cabinet seated in the black walnut chair that I just showed you, which you can see circled on screen. So these chairs, seemingly everyday items, were actually artifacts and witnesses to one of the most important moments in White House history. Pretty cool.
Yeah, very cool. And thank you for sharing some of your thought process with us. As you were looking closely for these connections between White House art and slavery, did you come across anything in the White House collection that surprised you?
Definitely. So many interesting stories came about. Some of them didn't even make them into the exhibit. But something that I found was interesting and surprising is a silhouette. So we can pull up the silhouette. And there's a section in the exhibit that's focused specifically on the work and the role of enslaved artisans. So these are enslaved individuals who labored in the shops or the studios or the workspaces of American artists, blacksmiths, sculptors, among others. Some of them the most famous artists of their time. And I already knew before I started the exhibit that I wanted to include somebody I had researched previously, a man named Moses Williams. He was an enslaved artisan that was owned by very famous American portraitist Charles Wilson Peel. And I already wanted to try to include Moses in some capacity in this exhibit because Charles Wilson Peel simply has many, many artworks in the White House, several presidential portraits. And so do his sons, in fact. And Williams' story is an interesting one. Moses worked as an enslaved apprentice for many decades in the Peel family. And Charles Wilson Peel opens a Philadelphia museum in 1786 and trains Moses in silhouette making. In fact, you can see Moses represented in a silhouette here. They called him a cutter of profiles. And using a machine that's called a physionotrace, which is an early silhouette machine, Williams at the museum every day would trace and quickly reproduce likenesses of sitters at the museum, essentially making them a little souvenir that they could take home with them. And according to Charles Wilson Peel's son, Rembrandt, because hilariously, Charles Wilson Peel named all of his sons after famous painters, he wrote that this soon became so profitable for Moses Williams that his father insisted upon giving him his freedom 1 year in advance. So Moses Williams actually is able to get his freedom early because of his skill as an artist and an artisan. And while doing this research, if we can go back to the last slide, I found this silhouette, which is included in the exhibit, and it's labeled on the back, which you can't see here, Peel's Museum, which led me to think, wait, this might be a silhouette made by Moses Williams, which of course was so exciting at the time. However, then I found out that forgeries of Peel's Museum silhouettes abounded in the 20th century. And after asking a few experts and historians, the size and appearance of this piece in the White House collection actually suggests that it might be a forgery, not an original. But I think it's still so interesting that the White House has a reproduction modeled after artwork made by an enslaved man.
That's a very interesting discovery. And I'm thinking a little bit now about format and presentation. Why did you choose to showcase this research as a digital exhibit? Is there significance or certain benefits in being able to consume this information in this format?
Definitely. It's a good question. I love that with a digital exhibit, like something like this, anybody, anytime tuning in at home can access this information. This content is available 24/7. You don't have to wait for a museum's opening hours to see it. It's very accessible. But I also love that it allows access to art and objects that are in spaces of the White House that aren't open to tourists and visitors. So there are many areas of the White House, obviously, that you cannot go, even if you go on a tour. And one of my favorite areas is the Lincoln bedroom. Several pieces in my exhibit are from the Lincoln bedroom on display in the bedroom. And it's this final section that I created about emancipation and abolition. The Lincoln bedroom is on the second floor, and it's filled with pieces related to Lincoln's presidency because it used to be his office, not his bedroom. Easy to mix that up. And it was in this room that Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. So one of the artworks, which you can see on screen here, it's one of my absolute favorite pieces in the White House collection, represents that moment. And it's called Watch Meeting, December 31st, 1862, Waiting for the Hour. And this was painted by an artist named William Tolman Carleton. The painting, which you can see on screen here, depicts a group of enslaved people and others as well, gathering to count down together before the Emancipation Proclamation officially took effect on midnight on January 1st, 1863. So it's a really moving piece. There's a lot of emotion here, the sense of urgency that time is ticking down to this really important moment for so many people. And the work itself is highly symbolic. A copy of the Emancipation Proclamation is on display at the very top right-hand corner. The American flag is also visible in the painting. In the center, there's a stopwatch to show that passage of time, that waiting for the hour. And on the side of it, an anchor hangs off, which is meant to be a symbol of hope. So there are a lot of cool symbolism here. I could go into it for a long time, but for time's sake, I'll just leave you with that. And this painting also has an interesting story of how it came to the White House, the story of its provenance, which is that abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison, a very prominent anti-slavery advocate in the 19th century, a friend, sometimes foe of Frederick Douglass, and the publisher of The Liberator, an important anti-slavery newspaper, actually gifts a copy of this painting to President Lincoln in 1864. And Lincoln actually enjoyed the painting. We have proof of him saying to Garrison that it was a, quote, spirited and admirable painting. And today, the painting in the White House collection is actually an unsigned, undated version of that piece. We believe that original painting that was gifted to Lincoln by Garrison left the White House with Mary Lincoln after his assassination. And we actually don't know what happened to it, which is one of those unfortunate things about these moments in history, is that at this moment, we're not sure what happened to the original Waiting for the Hour. But this version, which later comes back to the White House during the Nixon administration, may have been an early study by Carleton that eventually became that final painting gifted to Lincoln. But one of the other cool things about the digital nature of this exhibit means that you can actually zoom in on this painting on the web page, which you certainly could not do even if you were allowed into the Lincoln bedroom. So just one more good thing about a digital exhibit.
I have one last question for you, Sarah, before we open it up to our audience for Q&A. How can viewers access the exhibit, and what do you hope they take away from it?
Definitely. So as far as the takeaway goes, so many of us are aware of the fact that slavery is deeply connected to the economics and the politics of America leading up to the Civil War. But I hope that this exhibit shows that it's also deeply ingrained into American art and culture, that it touched every aspect of society. And I hope that it also reminds viewers of the integral role that slavery played in the construction and the early labor force at the White House. While so many of these enslaved people may not have left written records or archival materials for us, objects provide this lens for us to learn more about their lives and their connection to the White House. So all these stories are part of the exhibit. If you want to check out more, they can be found on our website, whitehousehistory.org. I think we'll also drop in the chat a link to that exhibit. And if anybody at home is interested in learning more generally about our Slavery in the President's Neighborhood initiative, you can also find that at whitehousehistory.org.
Thank you so much for taking the time to walk us through your exhibit, Sarah. We're going to open the floor for questions from our audience, and we have a few questions coming in. I'm going to start with one from Lorenzo, who's asking, you mentioned that there's a White House collection. Is all this stuff stored at the White House, or do presidents take furniture home?
That's a really good question. Thank you, Lorenzo. You're right. It's so much stuff, right? How could it possibly all fit into the White House? So on one of the first slides I showed, you can see that there are some storage facilities that are on the ground floor of the White House. The curator's office has small storage for extra items there, but a large majority of these additional pieces, there you can see it on the left-hand side, but a large majority of these pieces are actually stored off-site. It's confidential where they are. Even I can't tell you exactly the location, but it's a large warehouse full of these pieces that are in the White House collection. And to your question about do presidents take the furniture and paintings home, this used to be the case prior to having the White House become a protected museum with a curator's office. So presidents in the 19th century certainly did bring things home, sell them away, bring them back, etc. But now presidents and first ladies cannot do that because these items are protected by Congress. So you keep everything where you are and the curators take care of them.
We have another question from JJ, who asks, how do you track the enslaved people who worked on or at the White House?
That's a great question, JJ. And it's one of the difficulties of doing this research is that you have to be creative in what you look for. So a large portion of the names that we found of enslaved laborers who built the White House come from government receipts and government documents about construction projects on the White House. So we've gotten a lot of names through those, which many of them are actually held at the National Archives here in Washington, D.C. That's a tedious process of going through these old microfilm reels, but our historian team and my colleagues have done fantastic work in trying to track some of these names down. Other ways that we find information about these enslaved workers can come from a variety of places. Sometimes it's looking at memoirs, which are written some by formerly enslaved people like Paul Jennings, an enslaved man who worked in the Madison White House, who names other workers. Some of it are presidential letters and letters that they write home. For example, Thomas Jefferson meticulously kept records of payment stubs that he was paying enslaved workers to get new shoes, or writing letters home about other people that are in this household. So it's a mixture of these things, and that's part of the interesting aspect of being a historian, is putting together the puzzle and looking in these different places to try to find these names.
We have some good questions, a similar one from Jeremiah and Rose from Facebook, they're asking, are there any artifacts in the White House collection that were used by enslaved people?
Great question. So in terms of objects that would have been actually used personally by an enslaved person, there are not. Things like a hairbrush or a jug or some of these items that you might find through archaeological digs that are done at plantations, et cetera, those are not part of the White House collection because the White House has changed so much over time. And because, typically speaking, objects belonging to enslaved people were not seen as worthy of preservation. And this is one of the difficult things about doing this research, is that we have to get creative in finding ways to tie enslaved people to these objects that they would have interacted with, because the objects that actually belonged to them probably were not preserved. They were also probably used, so much so that you wouldn't have something to keep, versus a wealthy family who might have a beautiful sugar bowl that they sometimes take out of the cabinet, but that most of the time isn't being touched. That's why some of these fancy items are the ones that museums have, because they're actually preserved versus these everyday belongings. So as far as the actual White House collection and these artifacts that enslaved people would have used, there's nothing that is a personal artifact, but the best we can do is to look at this exhibit and other objects that have these levels of stories we can tell to find out those stories about enslaved people.
We have a question from Claudia, who is asking if there's anything that you wanted to include in the exhibit, but you didn't. I'm thinking a little bit too about this in terms of your research process. How did you choose which objects to tell these stories when I'm sure there, as you mentioned, there are thousands in the collection?
Yeah. So in terms of, I'll start with the research process, which for this exhibit, it depended on what portion I was working on. But I think one of the more tedious examples that is fun for a historian, but to anybody who is not a historian probably seems really boring, is that to do research on enslaved artisans and to try to identify enslaved artisans who may have been tied to these pieces in the White House collection. I sat down for several days and went through catalog items of pieces in the White House collection, pulled out names of artists that I was unfamiliar with that were working pre-abolition, did research into if they owned enslaved people, and then did the next step of research into if those enslaved people would have possibly worked in their workshops, in their studios. So that was a very tedious process of trying to dig into as many artists as I could. In terms of things I wanted to include but didn't, the thing that comes to mind is that by nature, this exhibit focuses on objects that are in the White House collection that are tied to slavery and freedom. But there are lots of objects that left the White House that have these stories ingrained into them as well. And as I said, until the Kennedy administration, people just willy-nilly would get rid of artifacts, give them away, sell them at auction. So one really cool object that I believe is actually at the Frederick Douglass House, which is just outside of DC in Anacostia, there is a cane that belonged to President Abraham Lincoln that after his assassination, Mary Lincoln gave this engraved cane to Frederick Douglass to thank him for his sometimes friendship, sometimes partnership that he had with President Lincoln. Douglass was a vocal critic about many of Lincoln's policies, including dragging his feet on emancipation. And they later worked together to try to get more African-American troops into the Union Army. So they had a really fascinating relationship. We actually explore it in our Slavery in the President's Neighborhood initiative. But an object like that cane that was gifted to Douglass is so indicative of the stories of slavery and freedom at the White House, but it's not in the collection, so I couldn't include it.
I have another really good question from Samantha, who's asking, post-slavery, is there a legacy of art or furniture or objects from African Americans in the White House collection? Yes. For example, are there any paintings from Black artists?
Awesome question. I love that one. So we have lots of great examples in the White House collection by Black artists. The first piece added to the White House collection by a Black artist is Sand Dunes at Sunset. It's by Henry Asawa Tanner, a really important, prominent African-American artist. The most recent acquisition was the first work by a Black woman artist in the White House collection is Alma Thomas's Resurrection. That was unveiled in the family dining room by First Lady Michelle Obama for Black History Month. We also have Jacob Lawrence's The Builders, a really great, more modern take on art. It's a little bit different than some of these older pieces in the collection. And Jacob Lawrence was such a great African-American artist working in the Harlem Renaissance time, painting The Great Migration most famously. So there are some really cool pieces in the White House collection done by Black artists long after slavery.
Melissa from Facebook asks, are you still continuing this research?
Oh, great question. So we are always continuing our research for slavery in the President's Neighborhood. We continue to mine documents to try to find more names of enslaved people who lived and worked at the White House. We continue to work with other historic sites to find the names of these individuals. So it's an ongoing process. And I think it's the kind of process that never truly ends because of how difficult it is to find some of these names and how hidden some of this information has been. So I think it's one that people long after our time at the association will continue to work on for many decades, I hope to come, and to find more of this information.
We do have another question about what other digital exhibits we have, which I could answer. We do have a growing collection of digital exhibits on our website that focus on several topics in White House history and are created by various curators. Our most recent launch was an exhibit titled Something Old, Something New, Eight First Daughters, Fashionable White House Weddings, which looks at the weddings of eight first daughters who were married at the White House and examines how bridal fashions have changed over time. Another one of our historians, Lena Mann, curated a really fascinating exhibit called The President of the United States Meets the King of Rock and Roll that details Elvis Presley's infamous visit to the Nixon White House. And we have a few other exhibits that are worth checking out, including one that delves into the lives and careers of eight women seamstresses whose work were really influenced by some of the looks of the first ladies. But we are continuing to add to our current collection of digital exhibits, so certainly keep an eye out on whitehousehistory.org for any of our new launches. And we'll just ask maybe one or two more questions for Sarah. Nicole from YouTube asked, if you had the ability to bring any artifact back to the present, what would it be and why?
Oh my gosh, that's a fun question. Oh man, the first thing that comes to mind is actually completely separate from this entire exhibit and not related to these stories of slavery, but I'll just drop it because it's a fun mystery and maybe everybody can noodle on it when we're finished here. So one of the most famous items ever installed in the White House is the Tiffany screen, installed by Lewis Comfort Tiffany during Chester Arthur's administration. It was a massive stained glass doorway. It was removed from the White House during the Theodore Roosevelt renovation, and it has unfortunately since been lost to history. So nobody knows what happened to the Tiffany doors. There are a lot of questions, there are a lot of conjectures and theories, but nobody knows. And so that's one that comes to mind as a White House historian that we talk about all the time, we wonder. So if I could bring back the Tiffany screen, I might do that just because it's such a fun mystery.
I have two more questions just because we have so many. This one will be from Colin, who asks, what other prominent presidents utilized enslaved people in the White House?
Good question. So as far as actually using and relying on enslaved labor at the White House, we know that nine presidents at least brought with them or hired out enslaved workers. And those are Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, James Monroe, John Quincy Adams, Andrew Jackson, Martin Van Buren, John Tyler, James K. Polk, and Zachary Taylor. And then there are several other presidents, of course, who owned enslaved laborers at some time in their life, but either didn't bring them to the White House or never lived at the White House, like George Washington, Ulysses Grant, Andrew Johnson, et cetera.
And I'll end on one more question for you, Sarah. Gail Jessup White from Facebook asks, are you working with presidential museums to collect stories about the people who were enslaved at the White House?
Absolutely. One of the best things about this job is that we have a network of presidential sites that we work with frequently, and we convene them every few years to get together at a presidential site summit. And there are other institutions that are doing really, really good research on slavery in connection with the presidents. Places like Monticello, Mount Vernon, Montpelier, Highland, many others have provided such really good resources for us in doing this research. I worked with the Frederick Douglass site when I was doing research on Frederick Douglass. The Ulysses Grant site provided great insight when I was researching Grant and slavery. So all of these sites have been doing great work, and I encourage everybody tuning in at home to check out the things that they're doing to work with descendants, to do oral histories, and to really bring these stories of slavery to light. So thank you so much, Gail, for asking.
Sarah, thank you so much for joining us tonight for White House History Live. And don't forget to check out her exhibit, Slavery and Freedom in the White House Collection, and others at whitehousehistory.org. We hope you'll all tune into our next episode of White House History Live on August 15th, when Dr. Robert Watson will join us to discuss his new book, When Washington Burned, The British Invasion of the Capital and the Nation's Rise from the Ashes. If you would like to watch any of our previous episodes of White House History Live, you can also do so on whitehousehistory.org. Thank you everyone for joining us this evening, and we hope to see you next time on White House History Live.